Well, hello, everybody. How you guys doing out there? Oh, boy, that doesn't sound good. Are you guys doing okay? Did you have a merry, merry Christmas? Well, that is wonderful. We had a wonderful Christmas, and I just want to say thank you to all of you that, you know, we received so many Christmas cards and wishes of love, and thank you for being so wonderful and so gracious. And we got so many sweets. That's why we are doing the Daniel fast, just to let you know, because we got to get rid of all the sugar we just participated in, and we're not done yet. We still have a week of eating ahead, so that's wonderful. And but I want to remind you, don't forget the Daniel fast. It's really, we've been doing it now for 2 or 3 years, and it's been very significant. And then, of course, we like to open up the year with our prayer and worship service, and that's pretty phenomenal and really incredible. And so today, I'm just going to, over the next week, like I said last week, I just love these last few weeks, the last Sunday of the year and the first Sunday of the year. It's so wonderful. It's so filled with anticipation and filled with hope. And I know maybe we are full of Christmas right now. You know, we're all stuffed. But if you would just pay a little bit of attention this morning, I believe that what I would share with you might challenge you. Well, not might. It's going to challenge you. But it might also give you a way that God has for you. And I believe there's many of us in this room today that, how many of you would love to live out your potential? Okay, 4 of you, let's try it again. How many of you would love to live out your potential? And yet, I find that although that's our desire, although we want to live out our potential, there is so many of us that fall so short. And one of the things that happened for us during this time, something happens to many of us as we approach the new year. We are hopeful, and in some ways we are excited, and in other ways we're apprehensive. And like I said earlier, this is really one of my favorite times of the year. And there are several reasons for that. One of the things that I have done for many, many years, I've done this for many, many years. I take some time out towards the end of the year, towards to the beginning of the year. And I just, with me and the Lord, I just go away by myself and, get a hotel room somewhere. And I just meditate on where I'm at, where I've been and where I'm going. And that's always helped me to kind of recalibrate, because I believe that we need that. It's kind of, we need a realignment. It's very easy living this life and getting out of alignment. It's very easy just going through the motions of it. And sometimes, you know, I think that can really happen. But I think what's good is that we evaluate. What's good is that we slow down. Somebody say, slow down. And when you slow down, there's two things that can happen. First of all, you can look forward to what God has for your future, but also then you can glimpse backward. And I say glimpse, and I'm not saying look, because I don't believe that all of our focus should be on the past. I believe that our focus should be on the future, but unless we do reflect, we lack an understanding of where we need to go. The problem is that I find with a lot of people, and I know none of them are within the sound of my voice right now in second service, and none of them are online, and none of them outside right now, and I'm talking to the people who are not here, but isn't it true that many of us have found ourselves doing what? Repeating the same mistakes again and again. Yeah, I'm not saying for you. Don't say amen for you. Say amen for someone else, right? Isn't it true that, you know, one of the things as a pastor that really has blown my mind is that you walk with people sometimes through difficult processes. You walk with people and they've made some decisions, and that those decisions have led them not to some great places. And yet you find and God rescues them and God restores them and brings them back to a place. And then, you know, it's kind of like the pressure is off. And then the moment his pressure is off, they kind of slowly but surely go back to that same kind of habits and same kind of patterns. And then you see up ahead, and you know, hey, listen, you know, up ahead is going to be exactly the same result. You know this definition better than I know it. And what is the definition of insanity? It's doing the same thing over and over and expecting what? A different result. So therefore, what we have to do is we cannot repeat. We can't get stuck in the same habitual pattern of living and expecting that somehow things are going to be different. We have to make some changes. One of the songs that I love in the Old Testament is a song that David writes, and it's recorded in two places, recorded in Psalms and also in 2 Samuel. And David sang the song to the Lord, and it's significant when he sang the song to the Lord. It was right after the Lord had delivered him from all of his enemies. As a matter of fact, not only from all of his enemies, his family also killed all the family of Goliath and slayed not only one giant, but five of the giants were slain. And David was in a place in his life where his enemies were conquered. How many of you know that will be a good place to know that your enemies are conquered? But how many of you understand that you have an enemy that you are going to have to fight for the rest of your days? If you say to me today, Henny, you know, I don't want to have any enemies, then I want you to know, then you need to die. Because it's the only way as a Christian where you are not going to be opposed. It's the only way as a Christ follower where you're not going to be opposed. Why? Because you have an enemy of your faith and he is hell-bent on getting you off track and not doing the will of God for your life. He is hell-bent in you not fulfilling the purpose of God for your life. And, I want you to understand this, is that growth is not an automatic thing. It's a deliberate thing. And I want to read this to you, and then we kind of will dig through it and see how far we can get today. And I'm going to read out of Psalm 18, and I want you to listen to these words, and it really is profound. And I believe if we have the same attitude as David had, I believe that we could have a great 2022. It doesn't mean everything is going to be perfect. There's one thing that I know about computers is that sometimes when your computer is not working very good, they say you have to refresh it, right? So you hit a refresh button or you shut it down and so that it can reboot. You know, I think we need a reboot. How about you? I think almost the last 2 years, I think we need to reboot from it and kind of refresh a little bit. And I believe we can have that refreshing if we do this. Watch this, Psalm 18, verse 1. I love you, Lord. Say, I love you, Lord. Now notice this. You are my what? Strength. The Lord is my rock. My is my. Wow. Do you find this? Isn't this amazing? Listen to this. This is personal. This is intimate. I love the way David says this. He says, you're my rock in whom I find protection. He is my shield, the power that save me. So he's my savior and my place of safety. I called on the Lord who was worthy of praise, and he saved me from my enemies. Boy, do I love that. Isn't that incredible? But I don't want you to miss out on what David is saying here. Look at how he personalizes. He's not talking in the third person. He's not talking somewhere out there. He's talking that he has an understanding of what it is to have an intimate relationship with God that produces life change in his life. He says, I love you, Lord. I love God. Not we love God. Not it's a corporate love, God. I love God personally. This is a personal relationship. And then he says, he is my rock. He is my strength. He is my fortress. He is my savior. He is my God. He is my shield. I find my protection in him. He is my savior. He is my power. He is my place of safety. Can somebody give me an amen? It is an intimate reflection of knowing what God has done in his life. And I believe that we can experience the same. And I want to say this, and I hope you don't get mad at me this morning, but you might get mad at me. The problem when it comes to the things of God, and the problem when it comes to this time of year, is that we can act our way into feeling a certain way so that we can think we are making adjustments, but we actually are not doing anything to produce long-lasting results in our lives. God is not interested in you. The problem with a lot of us, and what God is not interested in, is just giving a short-term change. God wants to change some things in your life. He wants to uproot some things. He wants to plant some things in there, and he wants to develop some maturity on the inside of you. We just came through a whole year talking about what? That we must become mature. But I want you to understand something. There is no magic in this. If you are short and bald and fat on the 31st, guess what? When you wake up on the first, it's highly likely that you might look the same. Some of you don't believe that. Well, we'll wait and see. You see, the problem with some of us is that we want to see instant change over a short period of time instead of progressive change over a longer period of time.
So God takes us very, very slowly through a process, but he wants to take us through the process. The way that we have to do that is we have to understand what God is doing. Because the only change that comes automatic is the change of age.
Boy, it's only the old people. We only have two old people, me and Joycelyn, that are saying amen. Oh, sorry, Joycelyn. No, mature people. We only have two mature people in the room. But I don't even know. As you age, there are just some things that. This morning, I looked in the mirror and I got scared. I mean, you know, I woke up and I'm like, who, doggy? Who's that? And I realized it was me that after the fog cleared my eyes. I don't even know, when you wake up as an older person, you've got a fog that needs to be lifted before you find yourself. You know what I mean? This whole thing about, you know, we got people say, oh, you know, I jump out of bed in the morning. I haven't jumped out of bed in a long time. I slide out of bed. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Because I don't want to injure myself. I had a friend of mine tell me the other day, he threw his back out. And I said, how? What did you do? Did you do exercise? No, I tied my shoe. That's what he told me. I said, he says, yes, seriously, I tied my shoe and threw my back out. And I've been in pain for a month. I'm like, wow. You know, so as an old person, you slow down a little bit. You don't jump out of bed. There's no kumbaya moment. You kind of slide out because you know that most death occurs for older people in their homes. So you have to be very careful around your own house. So that's the only thing that can. But if we want true change to happen, there's going to be some things we need to do. And I want to show you this. And this is a very familiar passage. And I'm reading out of the Message paraphrase. And you're very familiar with it because we did a whole series on this. But I want you to notice the 2 Samuel 22. This is also that same praise song that he writes. And he says this in verse 21 out of the Message. God made my life complete. Somebody say complete. When did this happen? When I placed all the pieces before him. When I cleaned up my act, he gave me a what? A fresh start. Indeed, I have kept, listen to these words, I have kept what? Alert to what? God's ways. I haven't taken God for granted. And then listen to the phrase right after that. Every day, somebody say every day.
Every day.
Say it again. Come on, say it like you mean it.
Every day I do what? Review the way he works. Every day I do what? Review the way God works. The challenge that we have is that sometimes we have what I would term a smorgasbord approach to the things of God. And what I mean by a smorgasbord approach is kind of like we have the concept of buffeting God. And if you know what I mean by buffeting God, is that we do this, and we do this in our culture, and we do this in our lives, and we do this in our churches, and we say, okay, you know what? There are some things of God that I like, and there's some things I don't like, and I'm going to do it like like I'm eating at a buffet. Oh, I love this love of God thing. That's really my thing. But hey, how about this holiness of God? I don't know a lot about that. You know, I love this receiving thing from God. But hey, becoming a generous person, I don't really know about that. Hey, I love this, you know, life and life in abundance thing. But I don't know about this dying to myself thing. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And so what we do is we go to the Word of God with a kind of mindset, a smorgasbord approach mindset, and we reject the things that come to us in a strong way, or in a way that we have a challenge to receive it. I want you to know this today, that the Word of God is the truth of God, whether you like it or not, whether you receive it or not. And God's Word is going to come to you, and it is going to challenge not only who you are, it's going to challenge what you are, and challenge how you receive and what you do with your life. And at this juncture of where we are at towards the end of now 2021, this is the last Sunday, and I'm so glad you're here today. This is the last Sunday of this last year. What a way to finish this year in the very presence of the Lord. But one of the things that we are going to have to do is we're going to have to review our past and reflect on our present. We're going to have to review where we've been. Why? Because we don't want to repeat the same thing. We don't want to have the same result. People have the idea that, okay, if I want a different result, I just got to do things differently. But I want you to know that change does not start there. Do you know where change starts? Change does not start in your action. Change starts in your thinking. Let me say it again. Change does not start in changing your behavior. Change starts in changing your thinking. There's a lot of people that say, well, I want to change. The problem is you've tried to change, and as long as you force yourself and white knuckle the thing and hold on to it, you know, it's okay. As long as you pay attention to it, then it seems like you're going in the right direction. But the moment you let go of the wheel, the moment you let off the pressure, what happens? The moment you let off the pressure, your autopilot is set. But guess who sets your autopilot? Your autopilot is set in your mind. It is the predominant thinking that you have. The predominant thought in your life will be the progressive living of your life. The more you think in a particular way, the more you'll behave in a particular way. The more you think in a particular way, the more you'll act in a particular way. And the more you act in a particular way, the more habits you are built up in your life. And the more habits you build up in your life, that is the result of the lifestyle that you live. And that lifestyle will determine what rewards you will receive in life. That's how it works. Change does not happen from the outside in. Change happens from the inside out. If you want to change your life, if you want to change some habits, if you want to overcome some hang-ups, then you have to start thinking new thoughts. Hello, somebody. See, I was watching a thing the other day, and they were interviewing people, and this wonderful man came up, and they were just asking people about, you know, what do they wonder about and what do they think about. And this guy said something really interesting. He says, you know what I wonder? He says, I wonder why everybody is so angry all the time. He says, I wonder why everybody is so mad all the time. It seems like everybody is mad. And can I tell you, if you are angry all the time, it's because you are thinking angrily all the time. See, when you have a perceived injustice in your mind that is not getting set right, then you begin to be angry. And the more angry you are, the more depressed you're going to be. Why? Because depression is anger turned on yourself. And so the more you think in a negative way, the more you're going to behave in a negative way. You see, the understanding of God's word is very clear, and I want you to get this. Jesus says, out of the abundance of the what? Heart, what speaks? The mouth speaks. So how do you know what's in somebody's heart? How do you know what is the predominant thoughts in somebody's mind? It is what? It is the words that are what? Coming out of their mouths. Because the words coming, I'll put it to you like this, and you can understand this very clearly. Words are reflections of what you've been thinking about. Words are the audio of your mind. Because what you put out, that's why, you know, wife said, well, but my husband doesn't talk much. Well, maybe he doesn't think much. I don't know. But the reality is this, is that if you want to change your life, you've got to change the way you think. And everything that we do and everything that we understand, we have to review our thoughts first. Because if you don't review your thoughts, trying to change a behavior without looking at thinking, if you're negative all the time, you know why? It's because you are thinking negatively all the time. If you're angry all the time, it's because you are thinking angry all the time. Change your thinking, change your life. The book of Proverbs says, as a man what? Think so what? Is he? So you are what you predominantly think about. And that can work both positive and negative. You see, the thing is that you've got to watch what information you are receiving. So when you're in this place, I believe it's crucial David writes in Samuel, and it says this: God made my life complete. Somebody say complete. When did this happen? When I placed all the pieces before him. And I believe there are two questions you ask yourself very simply. The first one is, where have I been? When you review, when you look back, I mean, just be honest. You know, don't snow yourself. Just be honest where you've been. And when you evaluate, I want you to watch out for something. Because it is very easy when you evaluate your life, not only to become negative, but it's very easy when you review your life to blame everybody else for who you are and what you are. I should have had a better amen than that. Is it not true that many of us feel that we are where we are because of what other people have done? Many of us feel that what I am, well, can I tell you something? The day you become mature, let me give you a definition of maturity. Maturity is the day that you accept responsibility for your own life. Maturity is the day where you say, yes, I might have been born on the wrong side of the tracks. I might have been born on the left side or the right side. I might have been born on the tracks. I might have been born in the train. But it doesn't matter. I understand that. I understand that sometimes there are systems that were set up against me. I understand that. I understand that sometimes people had evil mindset towards me and even acted evil towards me. I understand that. But I'm now at a place in my life that I have made the decision and know that what I sow, I'm going to reap. And if I'm going to have a positive life, then I'm going to need a positive mind. If I'm going to reap what God wants of me, then what do I do? Why? Because the problem is what we do, we take our thinking and we set our thinking above God's word. And the moment you set your thinking above God's word, you know what that's called? That's called idolatry. See, we think we don't have idols. And here's why we think we don't have idols. Because we're not bowing down before some statue. We ain't stupid like that. We're not bad. But can I tell you something? We are bowing down before a whole lot of ideas and a whole lot of concept that's ungodly. We are bowing down before a whole bunch of things that is idolatry. Why? Because we have set ourselves, our mind, our thinking above the thoughts of God, which is in His Word. And the moment you do that, guess what you just did? You are now walking in idolatry. Oh, hallelujah. Are you okay out there? See, here's what we do. Here's what we have to understand. That's why Paul writes in the book of Romans, and what does he tell us? He says this in Romans 12, that we must do what with our minds? Come on, help me, church. You feel the longing there. You must do what with our minds? We must renew our minds. That word renew in the Greek means to make young again. If we're going to renew our minds, why do we renew our minds? So that we may what? So that we might be what? Transformed. You see, we are being transformed. There's a metamorphosis that takes place. Transformation only takes place when we have a revelation of who we truly are. You see, when you don't know who you truly are, you fall for any image that appears to be something that's good, but that might not be good. And you fall down for it and bow down to it, and you serve your whole life in a place where you act out your feelings instead of telling your feelings how to feel. You say, well, how can I do that? I just feel the way I feel. No. You feel what you are predominantly thinking about. That's what you feel. So when you allow your mind to have a thought that is consistent and predominant in your mind, that's the way you're going to feel. It's the same way in any relationship. When you feel a particular way, you know, I mean, we've got wives that says, well, you know, my husband is just, you know, this sucker just doesn't get his act together. There's your first problem. You just called him a sucker. Right? So you've just defined him, and what do suckers do? They suck, right? So you've already defined that guy, and because you've defined that guy, why have you defined him? You defined him, maybe he's done certain things, but now the predominant thought in your mind about him is that he is a no-good sucker. So guess what that no-good sucker is going to do? He's going to be a no-good sucking. That's what he's going to do. And the reality of that is that you've got to be able to say, well, wait a minute. You see, you've got to say, I've got to change the picture that I have in my mind in order to engage the process that God has for me in order to get to what God wants for me. You see, and how do you do that? You evaluate. If you want to clap, go ahead and clap. I got two claps. I'll take three. I got four. I got five. Can I get a sixth clap? Hallelujah. Here we go. Thank you. I'm here for the next few minutes. But you see, what do? You take every thought that enters your mind, and instead of creating, how do you not create a false image? How do you have a real image? There is only one image in which we must grow in, and that's the image of Christ. So what do? I take the Word of God, who reveals to me the image of Christ. That means who Jesus is, what Jesus does, how Jesus lives, how Jesus relates. And then now suddenly I have somebody that becomes my enemy. Now what do? I read the Word of God. I look at the image of Christ. I see, what did Jesus do for his enemies hanging on the cross? He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So the image that I live up to It's not an image of revenge. It's not an image of getting back. It's an enemy. It's a thought that says, hey, if my enemy is hungry, I'm going to feed him. If he's thirsty, I'm going to give him a drink. If he asks me to go with him 1 mile, I'm going to go 2 miles. Why? Because the image I'm living up to is not the image that the world tells me. It is the image of Christ in me. Why? So that I don't build up an idolatry in my mind and call that my identity. It is a transformed mind that produces a transformed life. The reason some of you are stuck in the same habits, the same hang-ups, the same place, you live every year the same year, you just, the date is just different. You know, 2019 is no different than 2020. 2020 is no different than 2021. And you're just kind of repeating that same cycle again and again and again. And then you blame God and you blame other people. And you go through all that process instead of just stopping blaming everybody else and start blaming the person that's responsible for thinking the thoughts. Let me ask you this. Can other people think in your mind? That's the one place that you are truly what? In charge. Come on now. Now, people might be able to affect my behavior. They might be able to say, no, you can't go there. You can't go into that place. I can't go there because people can restrict my movement, but you cannot restrict my thoughts. So if you can't restrict my thoughts, then that means I'm free to think any thought I want to think. Come on, help me, somebody. I know there's an IQ test here this morning, but it's very simple. So therefore, I've got to reflect and think about the thoughts that I'm thinking. Why? Because I want to produce a different result. So I'm asking, where have I been and how? Where I'm at today? Now, I want you to notice these verses with me as I'm bringing this to a close. Watch this, 2 Corinthians 13, verse 5. Again, I'm reading out of the Message paraphrase. And this is powerful. But before I go there, let me read you the context of what Paul is saying here. Because he gives the context in 2 Corinthians 12 and then starting with 2 Corinthians 13. And I want you to listen to these words. And I'm just going to, we don't have it on the overhead, but I'll just read it for you. And you can look it up if you want, 2 Corinthians 12, verse 19. Watch this. Perhaps you think we're saying these things just to defend ourselves. No, we tell you this as Christ's servants and with God as our witness. Everything we do, dear friends, is to strengthen you. So Paul is coming real strong at the Corinthians. Why? Because there's behaviors in the church that's not good. There's behaviors in the church that's not good. And so he is correcting it. And he's saying, no, this is not the way it ought to be. And so he's talking to them and he reminds them, hey, guys, you got to live right. Then he goes this, for I'm afraid that when I come, I won't like what I find. And you won't like my response. So he says, man, I'm going to come there. And by the way, in the next chapter, he'll tell you he's been there already 3 times and he's now coming again. And he says, every time I've come here, the behavior that I've observed has been exactly the same behavior. And he says, now if I come again and I find that there has been no change, he says, you guys are not going to like how I'm going to respond. You're not going to like it. And then he says, I'm afraid that I will find this. And listen to these words. Quarreling, jealousy, anger, selfishness, slander, gossip, arrogance, and disorderly behavior. Can I get a weak amen for that? And then he says, yes, I'm afraid that when I come again, God will humble me in your presence. And I'll be grieved because many of you have not given up your old sins. You have not repented of your impurity, your sexual immorality, and eagerness for lustful pleasure. So Paul is saying, and he's saying the reason God will humble him is because one thing that we want to know as speakers, as preachers, as pastors, we want to know that the words that we speak actually have an effect on people. The letter that we are writing is not a letter so that we can just have an audience to sit here and clap and sing kumbaya and give an offering. What is this all about? It's about transformation. It's about lives being changed. And Paul says, I preached the word of God to you. I've written to you before. And now he says, and when I come there and I see that there has been no change. Now, I don't try to be funny here, but that gives me a little bit of encouragement that even the Apostle Paul had to deal with people after he preached who still didn't listen to what he had to say. Hello, somebody. So that's a little bit encouraging to me. It's like the pastor who gave up pastoring and he went and worked for the funeral home. And a guy was asking him, man, how is it? He says, it's great. He says, what do you mean it's great? You're dealing with dead people. He says, yes. He says, the difference between what I did before and what I do now, he says, now when I straighten them out, they stay straight. Living people wiggle, don't they? Hey, you're part of that. And he says, I'll be grieved because many of you have not given up your old sin. He says, there's no life change. So that's the context. And I'll go back to the other verse here in a moment. And then he goes and he starts this. This is the way he starts in the very next chapter. He says, I'll give you all the proof you want that Christ speaks through me. Because here's what happens. Here's what happens. When we don't like what someone is saying, or we don't like a truth that is being shared, whether it is a truth that is written in the Word of God, or whether it is a truth that comes through somebody, here's what we try to do. We try to discredit the source. We try to say, well, that guy doesn't know what he's talking about. Well, he doesn't understand the whole new world we're living in. Well, you know, the Word of God, it doesn't really speak about that. Or you know, that part of the Bible doesn't really apply to us today. Hello? Watch this. Listen to what he says. Christ is not weak. Somebody say, Christ is not weak. When he deals with you, oh, I love this. He is powerful among you. Although he was crucified in weakness, he now lives by the power of God. Wow. Paul is saying you've got to understand that this Jesus that was crucified is no longer crucified. This Jesus that you saw him in weakness, but the weakness that you saw him was in the weakness for your sake so that you could relate to him, so that he could die in your stead. He says, but this Jesus no longer operates in that weakness. He now operates in power. I want you to understand, when Jesus returns, he's not coming back as meek and mild. He's coming back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our God and of his Christ. And he shall reign forever and ever and ever. We serve a God that's on the throne, not on the cross anymore. And we must understand this. Yes, we thank God for the cross. We boast in the cross. We revel in the cross. We rejoice in the cross. But we understand we live in the power of the cross on a daily basis. But I understand that I have been crucified with him. But the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of God and the Son of God who gave himself as a sacrifice for me. I now live in the power of his resurrection, knowing who he is. Meaning what? Every other image in my mind that does not uphold who he is must come down. See, we deal in the realm without rules. What's the realm without rules today? The realm without rules is what I would term the shop window mentality. We judge everything by how we feel. We say, because I feel this way, I am this way. No, Paul says, because you think that way, therefore you act that way. So change what you think, because you got to be very careful the information that you allow to come in to your heart and mind. Because if you allow the wrong information, your operating system is going to be wanky. You're going to have a virus. Hello, somebody. Are you still out there? Are you listening to what I'm saying? We too are weak just as Christ was, but when we deal with you, listen to what he's saying. I mean, these are strong words. How many of you understand? Paul is not pussyfooting around here with the Corinthians. He says, when we deal with you, we will be alive with him and will have God's power. And then he talks about further on in that chapter 13, he talks about the apostolic authority that God has given him. And he says, you guys are supposed to really be the ones that know my apostolic authority. You see, why do we question somebody's word? Because we want to question somebody's authority. Why did they do that? Because they understood better than you and I understand that God only operates through authority. And unless we submit to his authority, that's why Paul writes to them when it came to tongues and prophecy. And he said, let everything be done decently in order. Decently in order doesn't mean quiet. It means it's like an army marching. That means there's order in the army. There's ranks in the army. That's why he says, and I'm going to use this just to kind of help you understand this. And I hope you get this. It's because that's why he uses the term that you can recognize and understand. Even in Ephesians chapter 6, he says the devil's domain is a domain where there's ranks and file. There are different levels of authority even in the kingdom of darkness. And he says this, if the devil understands that in order to get stuff done, you have to operate through authority, then you got to understand better than that, that God knows exactly. That's why when Michael the archangel in the book of Jude, when he had a conversation with the devil over Moses' body. Now, we don't have that recorded for us, but we have this record that he said this. He said, the Lord rebuke you. Why does he say the Lord rebuke you? Because obviously the Satan had authority greater than Michael's when he was in God's kingdom. See, God has lined things up through authority so that we can submit to it, so that we can have an operating place in freedom. Authority should not be dominating us, it should be liberating us. But we run away. Because here's what we do, is we glorify the rebel in us. We think because I'm a rebel, that shows really how smart I am. No, you actually show how dumb you are, that you don't even understand the very basics of the kingdom of God. Am I stepping on anybody's toes here? I'm trying to. God works through authority. So let's go back to that decent and an order thing. Let's just talk a little bit about prophecy. That's why Paul says this. He says, when one person prophesies, but another one comes and has a greater revelation, meaning because they have a greater revelation, is because maybe they're greater in rank or greater in gifting. And if they are greater in gifting, let the other person shut down and let that person that's greater in gifting, let them speak out. Why? Because God touches through headship. If you think I'm pulling this stuff out of my rocker, do you remember in the book of Acts, the Bible says Philip had daughters that what? Prophesied. And they were prophesying until what happened? They prophesied in the church, and then Agabus the prophet came, and then guess what they did? They stopped prophesying. Why? Agabus, which had the office of a prophet, came, which means his rank was higher than theirs. Although they had the gift of prophecy, they were not prophets. So guess he walked in the office of a prophet, and because he walked in the office of the prophet, they were willing to submit their prophetic gift to one that is greater than them. Why? Because this kingdom works through submitting to authority. So Paul says, the reason you can't receive what I'm saying is because you're trying to challenge my apostolic authority. Oh, church, we're so shallow in our understanding. Are you hearing what I'm saying? It's because somehow somebody sold us a bill of goods, and we believe that lie, and we've built up an image around a theology that's not Christ-like. And we hold on to it so tight that it has become a sacred cow. Can I tell you what we should do with sacred cows? We should slaughter them and cook them and eat ribeye. Can I park here for one more minute? Yes. Some of you look at me like real funny. That's okay. I'm okay with that. Look at 2 Corinthians 13:5. Now reading out of the Message paraphrase. Watch what he says. Can we put it up? Is it up on the screen?
Yes.
You want to read this with me? 1, 2, 3. Test yourself to what? Make sure you are solid in the faith. Don't drift along taking what? everything for granted. And listen to the next four words. Let's read as loud as we can. One, two, three. Give yourselves regular checkups. It didn't say give your neighbor a checkup. For you young lads, it didn't say check out your neighbor. He said give yourself a regular checkup. Why? You need firsthand evidence, not mere hearsay, that Jesus Christ is in you. Test it what? Out. If you fail the test, do something about it. What a perfect opportunity we have right now to slow down long enough to say, I'm going to make the Word of God the authority in my life. And I'm going to submit to where God placed me. That's why God wants to place you in a house where there's order. God places you in a church. That's why just attending a church, that doesn't mean anything. You got to become part of the family. Hello? You got to commit. You got to connect to the body. You can't just attend a church. And I know what we say, well, you know, you don't know what church I've done. I know all that. I understand all that. But at some point, you're going to have to accept your assignment and get in alignment with what God has for you and fulfill the purpose of God. Because when you stand before Him, you will have to give an account of what kind of steward you have been with the gifts and talents God has deposited on the inside of you. And so what God wants us to do is work together. Work together so that we can fulfill the ultimate purpose of God, and that is to build the kingdom of God. And it is okay. I don't have to be the number one guy. I don't have to be the number one girl. I don't have to be large in charge. What I have to do is submit to the authority that God has given over me and humble myself. And even if that authority is not 100%, here's what I know. I trust God. Because I know that sometimes God tests my heart through leaders that do not act right. There's a whole other sermon. I'm not going into it. Test yourself. What image are you holding up that's not Christ-like? What image are you believing that you are and that's not really you? Your Father's the only one who truly knows you. I'm going to pray for you, and I'm just going to finish the service a little bit differently. Pastor David, could you come up to the keyboard here? Would you just take a moment with me? Would you just bow your head and just close your eyes just for a moment? Those of you outside, those of you online, would you do the same? I know you might have some distractions, but if you would just take a moment with me. Lord, we know that your word says the steps of righteous people are ordered of you. We come towards the close of this year. And I know that there are people in this room, there are people online, there are people outside that have gone through a difficult journey. But I do know that in the midst of that journey that you are faithful. Lord, help us. Help us to recognize that if we allow the wrong kind of thinking in our hearts and in our minds, our operating system is not going to be healthy. Help us to recognize today that we must take full responsibility for the thoughts we think. So therefore, we must take full responsibility for the actions we take. And so we ask you, if there's any idolatry in our hearts and in our minds, anything in us that we have upheld greater than what you've said, that we've upheld greater than the image of Christ Jesus in us, right now we pray that there'll be full confirmation of what things need to be changed so that we can completely conform and be transformed in the image and likeness of Jesus Christ. Lord, we know that serving you is not just about singing a song on a Sunday morning. Serving you is not just about giving an offering once in a while. Serving you is not about clapping our hands simply. Serving you is about understanding the place that you've called us to and recognizing that you have us here in this valley for a specific season and for a reason, that we would not miss the assignment that you have assigned to us, that we would not miss when you are visiting us, that we would not miss the opportunity when you are restoring the hearts of people back to you, when you are bringing people back to life, that you're bringing dead places that were dead for so long on the inside of them, that you're causing it to be alive again. Let your people live in the freedom that you've given them. Help us not to see one greater than the other, but help us to submit ourselves to one another, not for anything but to glorify you and to function in a healthy way as your body. We cannot call ourselves, we will not call ourselves, but we want to be found faithful as stewards of your house. That's our prayer today. As you're sitting there right now, would you just take a moment and just kind of reflect? Just take a moment. This is not just about finding wrong. There's some great things that you've done, and you need to do more of those. There's some good thoughts you've thought. You need to think more of those kind of thoughts. There's some great actions you've taken. You need to do more of those. But just take a moment. We're in his house. Just take a moment. Just take a breath. Slow down for just a moment. Where else are you going to slow down? Slow down right now in his presence and let him just speak to you. Father, you've given us the tongue of the learned, that we should speak a word in season to him who is weary. You awaken us morning by morning to hear as the learned. The Lord God has opened our ears, and we will not be rebellious, nor do we hide away. Help us to see what needs to be seen. Help us to hear what we need to hear. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your faithfulness. We humbly submit ourselves to your purpose. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to close this service, and I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to ask Pastor David just to continue playing. And I know if you need to go, you need to go. That's fine. But if you just want to take a moment, just this last Sunday of the year, just take a moment and just let God speak to you. And just stay as long as you need to stay. If you need to stay for 30 seconds, that's fine. A minute, that's fine. And then once you're done, then you can go. And I'm going to invite the prayer team to be at the front. And if you need prayer, they'll be here in the front. And you can ask them to pray with you and for you, and they will. So I'm not going to finish in a prayer. I'm going to just allow the Holy Spirit to speak to your heart. And then when you feel you're good, just know you are loved.
Take this life and breathe on. This heart is now yours. You can have it all, Lord. take this life and breathe on. This heart that is now yours. You can have it all, Lord. And every part of my world. Take this life and breathe. This heart that is now yours. You can have it all, Lord. Every part of my world. Take this life and breathe on. This heart that is now. This life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. You can have it all, Lord, and every part of my world. Take this life and this heart that is now yours. Thank you, Jesus. Father, this new year we just dedicate our hearts, lives, our path, our will to your plan, to your purpose. And Lord, this new year, you have our yes. You have our yes. You can have it all, Lord.